the nation-state of Poland on the eastern borders of Germany had emerged periodically through the mists of European history, but never once in the same place as before. The resurrection of Poland under the terms of the Treaty of Versailles in 1919 had awarded that country a corridor of land connecting Poland to the Baltic and giving control to Poland of the ancient German seaport of Danzig. The Polish corridor effectively cut Germany in two. Throughout the interwar years, conflicts between Poles and Germans in the corridor led to increasing polarization. And by 1933, an indigenous Nazi party in Danzig had gained control of the city and begun agitation for reincorporation with Germany. By the spring of 1939, Hitler felt strong enough to demand the return of Danzig and access through the corridor for road and rail communications with Danzig and East Prussia. But any justice behind these demands had been undermined by his occupation of Prague and the dismemberment of Czechoslovakia. Incensed at what they regarded as a betrayal of the agreements of Munich, the British and French extended guarantees to Poland and urged Hitler to solve the matter by negotiation. On August the 23rd, the Nazi-Soviet non-aggression pact was signed in Moscow, effectively concluding Hitler's negotiations and signaling the death knell for Poland. In its secret clauses, the pact provided not only for the division of Poland between these two powers for the fourth time in its history, but outlined general agreements for a division of Europe from the Baltic to the Black Sea. As the German armies mobilized along the frontier, Britain dramatically converted her guarantees to Poland into a formal alliance, thus ensuring the inevitability of a European war. The invasion of Poland began at dawn on September the 1st, 1939. While the German armies crossed the Polish border, the Luftwaffe began a coordinated air offensive against both strategic and civilian targets in Poland. The attack on Poland had been in planning for several months, but the German strategy for the invasion had been in development for much longer. Although the German and Polish armies were numerically nearly equal, technologically and tactically, they were light years apart. Throughout the 1920s and 30s, the Germans had evolved a theory of aggressive warfare, which placed the emphasis on rapid armored advances supported by air attacks. Against 10 armored German divisions, the Poles could field only one armored brigade, the bulk of their mobile forces being cavalry divisions. Their artillery also was both antiquated and sparse. But it was in the air that the Germans had complete supremacy. Most of the 2,000 German aircraft deployed over Poland were modern specialist weapons. In the Messerschmitt 109, the Luftwaffe possessed the best fighter aircraft in the world. The twin-engined Messerschmitt 110 could be used equally effectively as a fighter or as a bomber. The Junkers 87, or Stuka, mounted sirens, which made its effectiveness as a dive bomber all the greater for its power to confuse and panic the enemy. Against columns of marching troops or refugees, the screaming Stuka was to prove a formidable terror weapon. The Polish Air Force, on the other hand, comprised some 700 planes, most of which were obsolete, the rest unquestionably inferior to those of the Luftwaffe. Its command and communication structures were woefully inadequate. In the first few days of the attack, the Polish Air Force was completely wiped out. The campaign in Poland was a war of movement. No front formed for more than a few hours. The attack had been launched across the northern, western and southern borders of Poland. In the west, the German armies knifed through the Polish front in powerfully concentrated spearheads. From the north and south, the German attacks were intended to encircle the Polish forces and prevent them from retreating and regrouping. Everywhere, the Luftwaffe attacked remorselessly, disrupting communications and supply lines. Attacking ahead of the army, the tactical bombers of the Luftwaffe performed the role of a highly accurate airborne artillery. On September the 8th, the first German units reached Warsaw. On the following day, remnants of two Polish armies joined together around Kutno on the Bezoro River and began a counterattack against the German 8th Army. The battles around Kutno were to be the hardest fought during the entire campaign. By the 17th, the encirclement of Poland's armies had been completed and Warsaw itself surrounded. That day, the Russians invaded from the east. On the 19th, while the Polish forces around Kutno were finally overwhelmed and marched off into captivity, German and Russian advance units met together as partners on the River Bug in central Poland. Surrounding Warsaw, the Germans had been demanding the surrender of the city since the 16th. But in spite of continuous air and artillery bombardment, the Polish defenders of the city continued to hold out. Their hopes rested on the expectation of French and British attacks in the west. Both these countries had declared war on Germany on September the 3rd. The Poles had also a secret military agreement with France. Under the terms of this agreement, the French were committed to a full-scale offensive across the Franco-German border 15 days after mobilization. The Poles believed such an attack to be imminent. The Germans, too, had reason to be concerned at such a prospect and determined on pulverizing the city into an early capitulation. The siege of Warsaw lasted only until September the 27th. Some 40,000 people were killed or injured in the bombardment. Hardly a building was left undamaged. With the fall of Warsaw, the last Polish resistance began to collapse. Mopping up operations would continue for only a few days. Simultaneously, a campaign of revenge and retribution was carried out. Enmity between Poles and Germans had existed for centuries. In the interwar years, the Germans in Poland had been subjected to harassments and persecutions. German retribution for these acts was to be only the beginning of a long and terrible ordeal for the Poles. First under the yoke of the Reich, and later under the Russians. The German attack on Poland had crushed that country's resistance in little over 30 days. Against the ferocity and tactics of Blitzkrieg, Poland had no effective defense. Though mobilized, the French had failed to launch their promised offensive, preparing instead for a long and static war in the west. Confident of the impregnability of their fortified defenses, the French were neither aware nor interested in the methods of warfare that the Germans had evolved. Arriving in France, the British were equally ignorant and equally unprepared for a modern war. In the spring of 1940, such complacency would be cruelly punished.